Okay, we are live. So good afternoon, everyone. Good evening. I am Tom Torme from Cosmic Comic Nation, powered by Comic-Con Radio, and I am blessed. I am truly humbled to welcome Susan Eisenberg to the Cosmic Comic Nation. You may know Susan Eisenberg from any number of different roles, including Wonder Woman on the Justice League and Justice League Unlimited series. Or just any the DC animated universe, as well as Sorceress on the He-Man, the Masters of the Universe Revelation show, which you can watch on Netflix, and from the video game industry, the games like Destiny 2. So thank you, Ms. Eisenberg, for joining me. I do appreciate your time.
My pleasure. Thank you for asking me.
Oh, yes. And I am truly humbled. And I wish I could lie and tell you that I hadn't been bragging to just about everyone I knew that you would be on tonight's show. So I'm going to pretend like I didn't do that, but I did. I ran around everyone I knew, even people I didn't know. And I was saying, Susan Eisenberg is going to be on my show. I'm so excited. So thank you very much for taking the time.
My pleasure. You're making me blush. And thank you very much. That's very sweet.
I know you have quite an impressive resume. You are a voice acting legend. What led you to kind of break into the industry? What was your introduction into voice acting?
Well, my introduction wasn't voice acting. It was just being on the radio. And that was a really long time ago because my dad had a business in Rhode Island. And I would go on the radio programs with him and do some advertising for his business. And so really young in high school, I would do the commercials for my dad's store. And I loved it. I just thought it was fantastic. And then, you know, high school doing plays and college doing plays, theater. And then, you know, I moved out to LA right after I graduated college. And initially the plan was to be on camera, to, you know, do commercials and television and things like that. But then I really discovered very early on that I wasn't comfortable in front of a camera. In fact, it was just the opposite. You know, some people can forget it's even there. And I envy those people. I'm in awe of those people, but I'm not one of those people. So I decided to pivot and go back to my roots, as it were, and pursue voiceover. And I went back to school and to take classes. I'd had some acting classes under my belt, but I hadn't had voiceover classes under my belt. So I went and did that. And then I did what everyone does, is I tried to get an agent. And I was very, very, very lucky in that I got an agent rather quickly. And then I've been off and running ever since. But I don't want to make it sound like it's been easy peasy. I mean, I said yes to everything in the beginning. You know, you want to do a ride over at Universal Studios? Yes. I mean, anything that I could get in front of a microphone, I would say yes to. And, you know, even now, I mean, it's just a very competitive field. It's very challenging. So it's not like, you know, I was on my way and puff, puff. It's just been the easiest, you know, road. It's ups and downs, like everybody.
Do you think part of the challenge, or maybe part of the appeal, or like as you mentioned, you know, it's very competitive, has been kind of the change in technology and the way audio can be recorded and transported, whereas maybe someone can set up a studio in their own home versus having to go to a studio away from, you know, you could do it more, with more accessibility, more ease, I guess.
But that's really recent. I mean, so when I started, you know, that didn't exist. And you know, it was very conventional the way you did it. And you had to go, you had to have an agent, and you had to, most likely you went to your agent's office to audition, and you tried to get a job. I mean, just like with Wonder Woman, you know, I auditioned first at my agent's office, then I got a call back and I had to go to Warner Brothers. There was no, you know, studio in your apartment or your home. That didn't exist. You had to show up and see people. You had to have a demo reel. You had to do all these things. You know, everything is changing now. COVID changed the industry dramatically. But when I started, also, it's so funny because when I started, people were like, what's voiceover? Mm-hmm. When I would tell them that was my, you know, pursuit. And now everyone's like, oh, do you do animation? Do you do promos? I mean, everyone's so savvy. And it doesn't matter if you're in LA or New York, you can be in any city in the country or abroad even, and you can work. It's so wide open, which has made it so much more competitive. It was always competitive when I first started, it was, but now it's on a whole other level of competition.
I can only imagine. What a bold move to go from Providence, Rhode Island to all the way out to LA. And really, what a risk taker. I mean, that speaks a lot to your character as well, that you would, oh, sorry.
But yeah, no, I mean, I think that may be the last brave thing I did. But more importantly, that was my mother who so wisely said, you know, Sue, you don't want to be 50. Like that was the old age. You don't want to be 50 and looking back and saying, I should have gone to LA and tried. And I'm so glad I did. I went to college in Washington, D.C. So it wasn't exactly Providence. It actually was Providence to LA, now that I'm thinking about it. But it was Providence, Washington, New York, Providence, Los Angeles.
That is amazing. And it's great that you had someone in your life like that that was your cheerleader and rooting you on, you know, encouraging you to take those risks, encouraging you to follow your dreams. I think if more people had someone like that in their life, the world would be a lot of different place.
You know, it's so interesting. I think with my parents, there was always that concern about stability and making a living. It still is a consideration. I talk to my dad all the time, and my mother passed away, but my dad is always still asking, you know, how you doing, and, you know, you good, and all of this. My mother, you know, they were so supportive. And at the same time, they were parents, and they mm-hmm. were always worried, you know, right. always. Right. And rightfully so. It's a hard business. And I was really far away from them. Yeah. So, you know, they never asked, they never stopped asking, you know, are you done yet? When are you coming mm-hmm. home? But, you know, I was very lucky that I had that kind of support. Very lucky.
Yeah. In terms of classes, as you were taking classes in voice acting, and you mentioned that you were taking, you know, you maybe have taken at a time where people were kind of confused about the concept, what voice acting is versus mm-hmm. In person, I guess, on screen acting. What kind of courses would someone want to take if they were interested in getting into the field? And how would it differ from on screen acting? Any particular skills that would vary greatly from one to the other?
Well, the thing is, I think acting across the board is what people say you should do. You like just become an actor, just right. focus on that. You don't want to, you know, it's not about being a voice actor, it's about being an actor. So you learn how to look at a script just like you would with a voiceover part. You know, animation is acting. And you have to make something come off of a page, whether it's an advertisement or a promo, that's your job. So you need to learn how to act, to create, to have an imagination, to build that imagination and feed it. The voiceover piece is that's where you learn how to the technical aspects, where you learn how to use a microphone, how to stand in front of a microphone, how to you know, how to be a professional,
right?
Slate, you know, how to slate your name before an audition, things like that. How to move papers around when you're in a job and the microphone can pick up everything, so you can't be moving papers around and making noise. How to do basic things like that. There's just a, you know, a fundamental approach to it that you have to go into that room knowing. And if you have all that under your belt, you know, you've done the acting classes, you're taking acting classes, and you've got the fundamentals of the microphone and what it is to stand in front of that microphone, then that's, you have so much more confidence when you walk into that audition.
Right. And I'm sure your professionalism also speaks to your longevity in the industry and just the amazing jobs that you've had over the years. In terms of recording, and picture us in a studio. Do you prefer a style where you're recording kind of in isolation? Or I know sometimes recording studios allow for maybe an ensemble where you have multiple people in the room recording at the same time, which is maybe a preference for you, or is that just situational?
Well, if you're doing an animated series like the Justice League, you always want to be with your castmates, right? We were always together. We at Warner Brothers, we were in this huge recording studio. So not only was it the seven of us, but it was also all the guest stars.
Oh, yeah.
And we would sit down and we would run through the script. We'd have a rehearsal and then we'd record it. And then they would listen to it and see if they had to pick up anything, any mistakes or anything like that. So it was, you know, you felt like you were part of something, and there's nothing like that. You know, it's the best. I've also had to do things where I was by myself, even though it is an ensemble, I'm by myself.
Right.
Not as fun, and, you know, not as helpful to the process. With video games, you're always by yourself, mm-hmm. and oftentimes you don't even get the script in advance. So you're just, like, you know, working on the fly. And you have to learn. That's why I say the imagination. You have to be able to kick that into high gear pretty quickly, because if you know, you have to pretend that you're in these lands surrounded by these people or forests or, you know, monsters, whatever that world is in the video game you are playing, and you have to make that real for the player. So I always feel like I'm in the booth with the player, like with Destiny. You mentioned Destiny, because part of my role in that game was to be a guide to the player. So I loved that because I always felt the player was in the room with me. But typically you're there alone, like in Injustice. I voiced Wonder Woman in Injustice, and you know, you're fighting with Superman or Batman or Harley Quinn, but you're there by yourself.
Right.
So you just have to create all of that. You know, you have a director, obviously, who gives you context and helps you find the performance, but you have to be able to create that for yourself.
I was extremely curious about the difference between the work ethic that would go into recording video for video games versus recording for animation. And you definitely just expanded on that, gave me some insight. But so take a character like Wonder Woman, which I believe, and you correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sorry to say, that maybe since about 2001, 2000, you had taken on the role. And as you mentioned, you know, in games like Injustice, you've continued that role. When you're dealing with different directors, do they often maybe defer to you as an expert now on the character? Like, are they looking for your advice or is it... Do you have that kind of ownership of the character?
I may have that ownership. That doesn't mean they'll respect that ownership. Right. I mean, I think it depends on who you're working with. There are definitely people who I work with. Like, I voice Wonder Woman in the DCU online game. Okay. And I've been doing it for quite a while. A lot of the people that work on that game were fans of the Justice League. And so they grew up watching it. And so there is some deference paid, but yet they have their own vision for what they want. And the director, you know, is Alex. He's tremendous. But, you know, he works with me. It feels very, very collaborative. Other projects, not as collaborative. You know, you're hired to do something that is somebody else's vision.
Right.
And that's your job. And so the fact that you played Wonder Woman in the Justice League, I mean, there may be a little bit of respect there, of course, but this is something else. This isn't the Justice League, and we need you to do it this way.
I understand.
So, you know, you're at the end of the day, you're a gun for hire, and you know, that's your job, you know, to give the director, the writer, what they're looking for.
So I understand that, and that absolutely makes perfect sense. And considering, and like you said, a lot of the people involved with the game grew up watching the show. And some of us, you know, maybe we're grown-ups already watching the show. But
But that's so, my fan base. I love that.
I got to tell you, I'm so proud that I have a 15-year-old who's probably on the other side of this wall watching Justice League right now, because I believe it's a few more days before it's exiting HBO Max, and he's trying to get caught up. And when he found out that I was speaking to you, he was enamored. So not only did you have an effect on gentlemen like me, and now another generation as well, and probably ad infinitum, you know, just children who are going to grow up. And when I read a Wonder Woman comic book, your voice is in my head. When I'm reading the book, that is Wonder Woman's voice to me. So
that is, you know, it is just the sweetest thing to hear that from people at the Comic Cons. We always we meet people like yourself, and then we get to meet your children, right? And to see the joy that people have from being able to pass it on to another generation. And so when I meet the fathers and mothers and then their children, you know, it's so humbling that it has lasted, because obviously when we were all at Warner Brothers all those years ago doing this, did we know it was brilliant? The writing, the, you know, Bruce Timm, Andrea Romano, Dan Reba, Rich Vogel, like all the writers, Dwayne McDuffie, brilliant people. I was
about to say, Dwayne McDuffie. Just every time an episode comes on, and I'm a little biased because I'm a big Dwayne McDuffie fan. So every time an episode comes on and I see his name, I'm like, this is going to be great. This is going to be a lot of fun.
A 1,000%. I mean, the man was extraordinary and a genius. And so you knew that it was special, but did we know that we'd be doing interviews and Comic Cons and things like that all these years later, and that people would still be watching and showing it to their kids? No. And it's like, we all, the seven of us, we just feel so honored that we were a part of it. I mean, that's how we feel, and that we were part of people's childhoods and adulthoods. So
In reference to Comic-Con, or comic conventions, I should say.
Yeah.
You mentioned that on a professional level, when you are working and working on Wonder Woman related things, let's say, you know that they are familiar with your work. But I'm sure that becomes something entirely different as you head to a convention and people are lining up around the block just to shake your hand and say thank you. Those experiences have to be truly amazing. Are there any kind of standout moments or just some really fun things that you enjoy about going to the different cons?
Well, it's so many things, right? So it's so fun. You know, you see the cosplayers, you know, there'll be a Batman cosplayer that comes up to me and it's like so adorable, and so many Wonder Women and little girls. I mean, I've posted so many pictures over the years, like babies with like little Wonder Woman outfits that just, you know, make me so giddy. So it's everything, right? So it's definitely fun. And then it can be very emotional. You're a teacher, mm-hmm. you know that kids can have a really tough time, and school can be really rough. And growing up, frankly, can be really tough for people. And people will come to us and they'll share their stories about how hard it was in their home or in their school, or they were bullied, and that the Justice League was part of their salvation. It was part of their relief from the real world. And to know that you impacted a child like that, and they were, and there they are telling you, and they get to tell you, and it means so much to both of you, you know, you and them. It's very, very emotional. And a lot of hugs, not so much, you know, since COVID, but a lot of hugs before COVID, a lot, because people need to feel that connection. And they're very connected to the character and to the show. And it's very moving.
I can only imagine how humbling that might be, and how, you know, and memorable it is to hear that. And I know you're saying it's impact, but in many cases, it could be so much as even saving a life. Maybe someone who is connecting with these characters, whereas the outside world is rejecting them, they find solace and they find a connection with the characters that you are now bringing into their living room. And that's such a personal thing. And I think a lot of people have a hard time understanding that, as we're inviting all these people into our homes through the TV, and we are connecting with people we've never met before, yet they feel so impactful in our lives. And that part of the fun of going to a convention and meeting someone such as yourself is to share those moments. And like you said, it must be really a tremendous experience.
It is tremendous. It is a tremendous experience, and it's a gift. You know, it's like social media has been a gift in terms of meeting the fans and being able to share with the fans. But, you know, conventions obviously are in person. It's a different level. And it can be quite profound at times and fun at times. And thank you, by the way, for the line around the corner thing. That doesn't happen.
The
only person I've really seen that happen with is Kevin Conroy. And his line was unending, and he would sit there and sign every last autograph and meet every last person. And, you know, he was never somebody who would get up from the table and be like, I'm done. He just, until the last person was there, he would not leave. So he had lines around the corner. I don't think I have that kind of popularity, but he certainly did.
I would be remiss if at this moment, I guess I didn't take an opportunity to kind of ask you about your relationship with Kevin. And I know Mr. Conroy passed away. Are there any kind of standout memories? I'm sure just every single one, as you think about them, is equally as special as the last. But I know, for example, just as my son is now discovering the show and discovering this unrequited kind of romance tease between
Wonderbat,
right. I you know what? I forgot to introduce that term to him.
Hello, hashtag Wonderbat.
I will definitely make sure to add that to the. But when you were recording Justice League and Justice League Unlimited, you were recording it in the studio with Kevin. And what was that experience like?
Well, it was when he was there, it was quite magical. Kevin was bi-coastal, so he lived in New York and he lived in Los Angeles. So a lot of the time he was in New York, he was, you know, he would kind of call into the studio and he'd be on the phone. But when he was there, you know, it was magical. There was only one person who was ever my Batman. Mark Hamill was speaking recently about not being sure he'll do the Joker ever again. And, you know, I understand it, you know. Right. I was lucky enough to only have Kevin. I never worked in a different project without him. So, you know, the seven of us, you know, we just had this really beautiful chemistry. And I don't know why, you know. It was just magical. And when we'd get together, it didn't matter how much time had passed, how long it had been since we read lines together. Mm-hmm. We just kind of fell back into it. Kevin and I got to do a lot of Comic-Cons together. And
You had posted a beautiful picture of the two of you from a Comic-Con, and it's always a pleasure to see it. And I think as you're trying to unravel the mystery of your magic, I think from an outsider looking in, it truly did look like all of you, George Newbern, Phil Lamar, Kevin Conroy, and the entirety of the cast. It generally looked like you not only enjoyed each other's company, but enjoyed your roles and enjoyed your job, and seeing that energy, that love that you had for the characters made us love it even more.
If you can't love your job voicing Wonder Woman, you're in the wrong profession, kid. That's, you know, I mean, if you can't enjoy and just relish in reading, being able to say Dwayne McDuffie's words, you know, I'd say I was directed by people like, you know, Dan Reba, but it was the animation that was directed by Dan, not me per se. You know, so much of what I really love about the show is the expressions on Diana's face, or, you know, Bruce's face, or, you know, Hawkgirl's face. Like, that's the director, you know, right. That had nothing to do with us. As much as we'd love to take credit for it, it had nothing to do with us. We all got together after Kevin passed away. So, it's an extraordinary bond to have with other people, that you were on this show and you created something that has endured, and that you have these relationships that have endured.
And I'm glad they are enduring. I saw your guest spot on Michael Rosenbaum's show. It is good to see that these relationships are enduring, and it again just kind of solidifies that you know, because sometimes you see people who don't have that kind of passion that you spoke out of, that don't enjoy the job as much as you do. And when I, as a fan, hear that, it kind of takes me out. It takes me out of the picture. And when I hear about the love and the passion that you have and everybody else had, it always draws us back in. To know that you loved it as much as we did is really great to hear.
But also, you know, I think we just knew we were so lucky. You know, that's it too. Like, was it the best job in the world? Yes, it was the best job in the world. And we were so lucky. I mean, we were seven people that auditioned for a job. Most of the time you don't get the job. And we got the job. And I think that we never stopped pinching ourselves. We got to be these extraordinary, iconic characters. You know, I wouldn't be here today talking to you if it hadn't been for that luck. And I never lose sight of that, ever.
Understandable. I think a lot of that too to contribute, as you mentioned, it being a team effort, right? Is your casting director on the show as well,
Andrea Romano?
I mean,
the best casting director in the world.
Yeah, right. I mean, as with Dwayne McDuffie, you know, you're in for a good episode. We saw that. What if you see her name? You know, you're in for an excellent cast, and she definitely has an ear for talent, for sure.
For sure.
Shifting gears, in more recent times, we've been blessed enough to hear your voice on Netflix with the Masters of the Universe revelations, which you can't see, but it's up there. And for an 80s child like myself, I was born in 78, so to see it come to fruition yet again, to see yet another iteration of the show, but this one done so well. What was it like? Did you get a chance to... was Kevin Smith directing in studio? What was that experience like?
Surreal. It was surreal. You know, he's so special as a director, and he makes you feel like a million bucks. And not every director does that. You know, it seems so basic that if you want to get a performance out of somebody, you know, surround them like a safety net and make them feel warm and fuzzy and give them confidence, and they'll give you a brilliant performance, or at least try to. Kevin's one of those rare people who he just knows intuitively what you need to feel safe and to do your best work. So that has been a great joy working with him. Now, we started in the studio when the show started, but then of course COVID hit, right. And then I'd be working with him remotely, but he directed everything I did. And
so when you say working remotely, am I picturing something akin to what's going on now where he's on video, yeah, and you're in a studio, a personal studio?
Yes. That's exactly. And when you say personal studio, in my case, it's a closet, not this, but where I work with him. So, because it's soundproofed,
right.
And you know, he's very hands-on. He's not somebody who's just going to hire a voice director and let her run the show. He's very much, it's very much his vision of what he wanted her to sound like. When I first got the gig, I went back to like the old shows and listen to other people's versions of the sorceress. And so I had a very clear idea of what I wanted to do when I came in. And it was nothing like what you ended up hearing in the final shows, because I initially thought to do her very ethereal character in a much higher pitch than my own. But Kevin's a huge Wonder Woman fan from the Justice League, and he wanted me to, you know, he liked that aspect of the vocal aspect that Diana had. And we tweaked it a little bit. Obviously, there's much more a maternal sound to Sorceress. But, you know, what I had initially just went out the window. Like, I didn't use any of it, none of it. So that was, but I did my research anyway, so I'm proud of that.
That's good. That's good. I like that. It shows that you're dedicated to the role.
I cared about it because I didn't grow up with these shows, so I have to learn how to, you know, learn what the universe is. He-Man, what?
I do have to ask, on the shelf behind me, you probably might see a Wonder Woman figure. I don't know if you could see,
I see Superman. Oh, yeah, there she is.
There she is. So I have to ask, when you have roles such as Wonder Woman or Sorceress, and then you head out to the store, do you look on the shelf to see if your action figure, the action figure of the character that you voice, is on the shelf?
I do on occasion. And sometimes I'm surprised by the fit. Like, seeing that doesn't surprise me, but like seeing Justice League toothpaste, mm-hmm, can surprise me. That's surprising. Right. You know, t-shirts and stuff like that, you know, you expect that, but toothbrushes and soap, you know, things that you wouldn't expect. It's like, oh, okay.
Yeah. Right, right.
It would be more exciting if we all got a piece of it, but we, you know, that doesn't happen.
Sorceress denture cream. That's weird.
Right? No. Right?
But I would imagine that in my situation, if I came across this on the shelf and I'm like, oh, you know, that's me, you know, to the person, you have to fight the urge.
It's fun. It's fun when you can. I was buying new glasses recently, and I was in a glass store and eyewear store, and they were all really young people in the store working. And I don't know how it came up, but comics and cartoons and things like that. And it turned out that they were all like massive Justice League fans. And seeing that reaction was so fun and thrilling. And, you know, I felt badly because I didn't have anything to give them. So when I went to pick up my glasses, I made sure that I brought a bunch of autographed pictures for everybody in the store.
That's really sweet of you. That's really cool.
Well, because they're huge fans, and they were like, you know, their expression, seeing somebody's expression. And then, you know, if I do the voice for them, you know, it's just fun. It's a kick. And, you know, how often can you make somebody's day? That's pretty amazing.
You're definitely making my day right now. So I will ask, in terms of that, as you encounter people at Comic-Con, or you encounter people at the eyewear store, especially for super fans as the one you described, is there like a line or a scene that they often reference the most? Is it the relationship between Wonder Woman and Batman?
A lot of Wonder Woman and Batman. You know, the last questions about Kevin a lot of times, or Michael Rosenbaum, the Flash.
May I ask, is Michael as fun behind the scenes as he seems on camera?
More. Yeah, he is just such a beautiful soul, you know, and he's a good boy. You know, he's just such a good guy, and he's such a decent guy. That's great. He's a lot of fun. I mean, in fact, like when we were doing the show, he was like Flash to me. He was like a younger brother, you know. That expression where Wonder Woman is like with Flash and just looking at him, in that photo, you know, I posted it actually on my Instagram with a picture of me and Michael at his house. And that's the dynamic. I mean, he's just, he's a cutie patootie. That's all I'm going to say.
That's a lot. A cutie patootie is a glowing endorsement. So
yeah. Well, listen, they're all good. You know, right. Maria, George, Carl Lumley, you know, they're just, it's a solid group of people. Andrea Romano, Bruce Timm. It's all just solid. Phil Lamar was the only one in the group who really knew anything about anything. You know, the rest of us were like, okay, wait, who's this one and who's that? Especially with Justice League Unlimited. That was like a whole other thing and we were just lost. But Phil knew everybody. Phil's a comic fan. So he knew, and he'd be on the floor reading comics during our recording sessions, you know, when he wasn't on the mic. And it was fantastic because he was like our go-to.
That's fantastic to hear. I'm definitely impressed by that. I mean, Phil Lamar just is such an amazing talent. I mean, everything he does, he's done, whether it was Mad TV or whether Samurai Jack, he's so good. He's such a talented man.
He's such a gifted guy. And I think people are so surprised when they meet him that he isn't like 6'3" and, you know, muscles and everything, because that's Green Lantern.
Voice, he's got quite a range. You know, he
unbelievable.
Everything from his Static Shock, Virgil Hawkins voice, which is so low and then goes so deep so high with Virgil and so low with John Stewart. He's
right.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Yeah. He's got an extraordinary range.
So I think I'm probably going to know the answer to this, but let's take Wonder Woman out of the equation for a second. Whether it's acting on stage in high school or helping your dad do voiceover for commercials, is there a role, and everything beyond, is there a role that you, when you think of your career to date, because I know there's a lot more to go, is there something that you are most proud of?
I think I'm just most proud of the fact that I'm still trying,
right.
You know, that I'm still in that booth auditioning every day.
Okay.
I think that's what I'm most proud of. It's, you know, I think when I started I do a lot of commercials. I used to do a lot of commercials. And so advertisers, their tastes have changed over the years. You know, it always changes. And you can be in, you know, you can be the flavor they're looking for. You cannot be the flavor they're looking for. And so you have to just hold on tight and keep writing, you know, and keep trying and keep showing up. And that can be challenging sometimes, because there can be really, you know, long periods where you're just not booking anything. And you think you're doing great stuff, like you're bringing your A game, and yet the phone's not ringing. And how not to feel despair over it, or dispirited, or you know, to let it affect your self-esteem. It can be challenging, especially if you have other things going on in your life. So I think I'm most proud that I'm still here, that I'm still trying to that I still love it. I just love it. And
I do have to say, I'm sorry.
You know, to still have that passion for it after all these years, because I started, you know, a long time ago. And I always tell people, if that's what you want to do, it doesn't matter that it's competitive. It doesn't matter that you live over, you know, you live in Minneapolis. It doesn't matter. You can absolutely get jobs and work and do this. So try. You got to try at least. So I'm still trying. That's all.
Well, that is definitely something to be proud of. Not only the longevity of your career, the professionalism of your career, but also that even at this stage, even in the competitive nature of the field, you still have time to impart wisdom on people trying to get into it. And I think everything you just said, and that definitely speaks to the quality of your character. And that's great advice for people who really, really need to kind of learn not to internalize it. That although the struggle exists and the struggle is real, that to persevere, to keep going, to keep pushing, yes, keep evolving. That is definitely, I think just about, I mean, for acting in general, but for pretty much any field, that is solid advice.
Life. I mean, and it's not to say that you don't have bad days, because you will, and you do, and that's okay. I mean, you know, they can't all be magical, but you can try. You know, I think showing up is a lot of it, and showing up with the attitude of, I want this, and I have a shot, and I'm going to give it my best.
So for anyone who would like to see you in person, are there any upcoming shows that you're going to be involved with?
There will be some, and I will be, you know, it's funny you should ask that, because I have a call with my booking agent later today. So there should be some things. So if people want to know where I'm going to be, they can always go to my website, which is SusanEisenbergVoice.com. And also just social media, because I'm always announcing things on there too. Even though Twitter's changed a lot, that's the platform I use the most, and Instagram. So, you know, I always want to let people know where I'm going to be, or if I'm going to be in something that they can see me in.
Yeah, I definitely will be keeping my eyes peeled, especially as you may eventually. I'm on the East Coast, so if you start making your way here, I definitely want to keep abreast of the engagement, so I could definitely see you. So that'd be cool.
Well, you know, I'm a New England gal, you know, right. I'm from New England. So, you know, any excuse to get back to that part of the country, I'm in. So I will keep you posted for sure.
I appreciate it. I follow you on social media, like you said, Twitter and Instagram. So those are definitely good places. As you mentioned, you update them with what you're doing, and that's always great to follow you.
Yeah.
And SusanEisenbergVoice.com, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So definitely. So Ms. Eisenberg, really, Susan Eisenberg, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it. I hope to keep in touch, and hopefully in the future to talk about other projects that you have, and would love to have you back on the show to talk about those things when the time is right. So thank
you. Absolutely.
And again, on a personal note, really just, I reached out to you through Instagram, and you were so kind, professional, and courteous, to the point where I was almost questioning reality if this was happening. So,
well, but you were, it was the same for you. And I told you that earlier, Tom, that you were so lovely in your communication with me, that I thought, wow, this guy's a gent. Oh, I'll be on his show. And
my mom will be very happy to hear you say that. My mother will be very happy to hear you calling me a gent. So thank you very much.
Well, she did good. That's all I'm going to say.
Thank you very much. And thank you for your time. And I look forward to working with you in the future. And it was a real pleasure speaking to you.
Thank you so much, Tom. And thank you for anyone who will see this or hear this. It's my pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.